harvest, can you just stand all over the room? And can you just begin to lift your hands and just exalt the King? Lord, we behold you and we honor you. We thank you for another opportunity to be in your presence, to be in your house, to be amongst our brothers and our sisters, to worship you on one accord and to give you all the praise, all the glory, all the honor, because that's what you deserve. You've been so good to us. So all we have to do is just to bless your name. That's what we came to do today. We came to bless your name. We came to lift you up because you've been good. You've been faithful. You've been good and you've been faithful. You've been good and you've been faithful. So I will bless the Lord at all times. Your praise will always be in my mouth. And I've came here and I've decided that I'm gonna bless you. I've decided that I'm gonna lift you up. I've decided that I'm gonna magnify your name. Lord, we make you big in this place. Lord, we make you big. We make you bigger. We make you bigger than our feelings. We make you bigger than our emotions. And we make you Lord of Lords. We make you King of Kings, because that's who you are. That's who you are. That is who you are. Lord, we bless you, we love you, and we praise your name. Have your way today. Have your way today. We align ourselves with your plan. We align ourselves with your agenda. Only you get the glory today. Only you get the glory today. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Come on, everybody shout amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, we're only here for you. We're only here for you. Yep. Put your hands together like this. Say, yo. Your praise from our hearts to your ears, all the glory is yours now forevermore. Here's our worship, all we can give is for you. We're here for you, so we dance, yeah. We sing, God, we worship. You are King, we're here for you. We give everything to the one who is worthy. Our hearts are ready, Lord. We're here for you. Oh, oh, oh. We cry out, oh. Come on, if y'all know it, say we. From our hearts to your ears, all the glory is yours. Now forevermore. Hear our worship, all we can give is for you. We're here for you. Lord, we're here for you. For you. Come on, let's sing it real big. We dance. We're gonna dance like David. And we worship. Desperate, Lord, for a touch from you. If you don't come, So we dance, hey, and we sing. God, we worship. You are King. We're here for you, and we give. We give you our love and adoration to the one who is worthy. Truly desperate and hungry for the Holy Spirit to fill this room. Come by, Holy Spirit. Come by, Holy Spirit, and please don't pass us by. We're here waiting. We don't mind waiting. So we dance. We sing, God, we worship. You are King. We're here for you. We give everything to the one who is worthy. Our hearts are ready, Lord. To the one who is worthy, our hearts are ready, Lord. Jesus, to the one who is worthy, yeah, to the one who is worthy, and we're here for you. Come on, Lord, we're here for you. We are here for you. That's the only reason why we're here. Yes, we came to be with our brothers and our sisters, but we came for you, because you're the only one that can heal me. You're the only one that can save me. You're the only one that can deliver me. So I came here for you. I came here to see you. I came here to get a touch from you. That's all I need. That is all I need. I need a touch from the Master. I need a touch from the Master. Behold the King. Behold the King. So Lord, we make room for you. We make room for you. We make room for you. We make room for you in our hearts. We make room for you in our minds. We make room for you in our plans. Holy Spirit, have your way. We are only here for you. We are only here for you. Holy Spirit, reign in this place. Drench us with your love. Drench us with your power. Drench us with your Holy Spirit. We want to overflow. That's why we came. That's why we came. That's why we came. You're the only one that matters. We set our gaze and our focus on you. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Behold, behold our King. Our King is coming. Our King is here. We behold you. We behold you. Hallelujah, we behold you. We behold you. O Son of God, O Perfect One, O Sovereign Ruler, we worship you today. We worship you today. We worship you today.
Hosanna, say Hosanna. Let's continue to worship the Lord. Let's just lift up our hands. When they sang, "Let your king be lifted higher," didn't you feel the atmosphere change? Can we do that one more time?
Let our king be lifted up.
Let's magnify him. Worthy are you, Lord God.
Let our King be lifted.
Yes.
Let our King be lifted.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, let our King be
Hallelujah.
Lifted.
Just worship. Just magnify his name this morning. Cast all your cares on him this morning. We lift up his name. Jesus. Jesus, you're worthy. Jesus, we call upon your name, oh God. Jesus, we exalt you in this place. We worship and adore you, Lord. We magnify you. Be lifted up. Be lifted up. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, be lifted up. Jesus. Jesus. Hallelujah. Can you give the Lord a hand of praise? And you shout out, Hosanna, Hosanna to the King. Hallelujah. For our God lives and our God reigns. Thank you, Jesus. Ooh, praise the Lord. You may be seated. Beautiful time of praise and worship. Thank you for your obedience and just stirring up the atmosphere of praise. First of all, good morning. God bless you. Good morning for those that are watching. Good morning. God bless you. And we just welcome you with arms wide open. Today, didn't you just feel like, I don't know, but you came in a certain way and all of a sudden all that is lifted up. Amen. Something about the name of Jesus. That name. It changes the atmosphere. It stirs us. Our spirit just leaps at the name of Jesus. So I want you to get excited. We serve a God that is good, who's worthy, who lives, who reigns. Amen. And I'm so excited to be able to just be part of this fellowship. These are rough times in this world. And the fact that we can come and gather together, to God be the glory. To God be all the glory. On behalf of Pastor Mitchell and his wife, Charlotte, and the leadership, we welcome you in Jesus' name. Grateful to God for what he's doing and what he will continue to do. And if you're new here today, or if you're new and you're watching via the internet, I'm excited. Sorry. Yeah. Yeah. Hi. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So if you're watching online, we'd like to welcome you. If you're here for the first time, please raise your hands. God bless you. One, two, amen. Three, four, hallelujah. Amen. So we welcome you with arms wide open. And I want to tell you about the mission here at Harvest. So the mission here is the three R's. And we don't take them for granted because I don't like when something is said over and over and you kind of desensitizes you. So it's really important for us to understand, embrace, and continue to proclaim this. Our mission is the three R's. And it's revealing God, reaching people, and restoring lives. and you're here today for the first time, this is what we're going to do in your life. God's already brought you here. And we believe that as you leave, you will also spread that mission. Amen. So let's get ready to pray for the tithes and the offerings, the second half of worship, the most beautiful part. That, let me tell you, we serve the King of Kings. Everything is His. Everything. But that we are privileged to be able to invest in the kingdom. And we invest for the expansion of the kingdom. And it's something that I know sometimes we don't have. But you're the offering. You are that offering. If you don't have it in the bank, if you don't have it in your pocket, give Him your heart. That's an act of worship and an act of service. So don't leave here saying, I couldn't give anything. You've given the best. You've given yourself. Amen. But in obedience also to the word, we present God the first fruits of our labors. And let's pray. Father, we thank you, God Almighty, that you said in your word that never, ever have the righteous been forsaken. We thank you, Lord, to be part of the expansion of your kingdom. We pray for every tithe, for every offering, because the evidence of even where I'm standing, Lord God, shows how your tithes are being used for your glory. So we thank you. We thank you to be able to spread the good news. We thank you, Lord, that we are able to invest in missions. We thank you, Lord God, that we're able to sit in comfortable chairs, Lord God. We thank you for a place that is warm, God. We thank you. We just thank you this morning. In a spirit of gratitude, receive our tithes. Receive our offerings. And in all things, Lord, be glorified. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen.
Hey, God bless you, everyone. I hope all is well. My name is Claudia, and this is what's happening at Harvest. Harvest Royal Family Kids will be having an 80s themed party on April 20th from 4 to 7 p.m. Entry will be $40, so to make a purchase, you can scan the QR code and select RFK Camp. There will be music, food, and lots of fun. So Harvest, you don't want to miss out. Harvest, our choir and worship team will be holding auditions for both musicians and singers. If you have completed or are currently enrolled in Experiencing God and would like to audition, please sign up on our website at hfcc1.org/teams. Next up, Harvest Go will be having a highway outreach. Harvest Go will be meeting here at the church at 10 a.m. and then head on over to Bruckner Boulevard. The outreach will take place from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. on March 30th. So Harvest, if you are interested, please come on out. Harvest, we are announcing Easter at Harvest. Beginning this Good Friday, we will be having reflection rooms from 7 to 8 p.m., followed by a worship service at 8 p.m. This will be a special service with 7 spoken words covering the last 7 words of Jesus. Harvest, this will be an incredible service that you do not want to miss. The following day, Saturday, March 30th, we will be hosting a concert at 6 p.m. The concert will have an admission fee of $10. Then, of course, on Sunday, March 31st, we will be having 3 services to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The first service will begin at 9 a.m., the second at 11 a.m., and our third and final service at 1 p.m. Lastly, Harvest, we are introducing Harvest Grow for anyone who is new to Harvest or the faith and wants to learn more about their next steps to grow at Harvest. We'll break down your growth track, teach you more about our church culture, get you informed about baptism, and direct you to begin serving at Harvest. Our next session will be happening today at 2:30 p.m. So we hope to see you there. Harvest family, that is my time. My name is Claudia, and this is what's happening at Harvest. Enjoy the rest of the service, and God bless.
Amen, amen. Do I have any grateful people in the room? Come on, if you're grateful, can you stand in the room? Lord, we're so grateful for your presence, for your sacrifice, for your love, for your faithfulness and your goodness. We honor you, Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
got to get up. You've got to get up. I command my body. I command my body. I command my soul. I will bless the Lord. I will bless the Lord. Even when I don't feel it. Even when I can't see it. But I will bless the Lord. So come on, my soul. 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 You've got to live. You've got to worship. You've got to pray. Come on, my soul. Come on, my soul. And don't you get shy. You've got a lion. Get up and pray. One more time. One more time. Say, come on, my soul. Oh, oh, oh. You've got a lion. Get up and pray. So I throw in my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a high. Broken hallelujah, send it up, send it up.
I'm just being prompted by the Lord, and I'm taking a step of faith. But I hear the Spirit of the Lord saying, I'm here to bring healing. I'm here to bring healing to your life at this moment. I know what the doctor's saying, but God says, I'm in control, and I'm going to take care of it. So I'm going to ask those who want to believe that God is going to heal you to remain standing. Those who don't, I want you to sit down, and because I want us to point in our direction. If you're fine, you could have a seat at this moment. But those who are sick and in body and believe that the Holy Spirit is going to bring healing to their life, praise the name, just stand up. And those who are sitting there, could you just point towards a person who's standing up around you in the name of Jesus? And let's begin to pray right now, Lord, the release of your Holy Spirit in the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. We're believing, Lord God, for restoration of body parts, Lord God. I know what the doctor's saying about perhaps cancer, or the doctor's saying about our kidneys, or God is saying about our blood pressure or whatever, but we serve a mighty God who is able to reverse it by your mighty power in the name of Jesus. And so we release your Holy Spirit power. Holy Spirit, you are a God who heals. Holy Spirit, you are the one who touches. And right now, in the name of Jesus, bring your healing power over those who are sick as they, Lord God, lift up their hands if they're able to in faith and say, Lord God, you're going to get rid of that sciatica. Lord God, you're going to get rid of that migraine headache. You're going to get rid of all these things, Lord God, that are weighing me down. Oh, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, you are the healer. Right now, Lord, you ask in Jesus' name, and we speak to that mountain in the name of Jesus, and we pray for healing at this moment, emotional healing, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Come against mental stress, mental anxiety, mental worry, mental fear, whatever is there, not of you, in the name of Jesus. Release your power. Do what only you can do right now, Holy Spirit. We trust in you. We trust in you. We trust in you. We believe in you. In Jesus' name, Lord God, release it. Release, 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 release. Release your power, Holy Spirit, right now. Hallelujah. We wait on the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, praise the name of the Lord. You know, Lord God, what only you can do. We've seen it over and over here at Harvest, Lord God. People have been healed from cancer, Lord God. We've seen people been healed and delivered. I pray, Lord God, right now for every body part, Lord God. For those who are having heart troubles right now, in the name of Jesus. Right now you're having heart troubles. We're believing that every valve, everything will be back, Lord God. That God will restore, that the doctors will not understand. We're praying right now in the name of Jesus for deliverance. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, Lord God. Hallelujah. For kidney failure, we come against kidney failure in the name of Jesus right now, Lord God. And I'm going to be very specific, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. We come against it in Jesus' name. And I don't know why it's coming to my mind, Lord God, but I'm trusting in you and believing. I'm believing right now, Lord God, whoever's dealing with these issues, right now they're going to experience your healing touch and a miracle that only could come from you, because you are a miracle-working God. How many believe that he's a miracle-working God? If you believe that he's a miracle-working God, give the Lord a shout of praise. Your faith in a big God will go a long way. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus says, don't you get tired of me. Hallelujah.
I can stand those.
Get up
and praise the Lord. Say, come on my soul. Yeah. Lift up your song. Side of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Say, come on my soul. Don't you get shy. my broken hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Thank you, Kadidia. Praise the Lord. We pray for her vocal cords. She was saying this morning that her vocal cords and anointing came through. Amen. God used her. Amen. Wonderful, wonderful worship team. And I saw the tech people were running around. Nicole, you were making exercise. She was running over here. She ran over there. And so let's give it up for Nicole. She's working hard. Praise the Lord. Part of the tech team. They all do a wonderful job, and Eli's upstairs. We don't see him, but everybody's working together the way it should be. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Woo. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. I don't know. It's such a good experience. Well, happy you guys survived the rain. I see, right? Praise the Lord. Amen. Some people came to church today in their canoes. That's all right. Praise the Lord. Remember, next week is 3 services. So please come out early. All right. Come out early, right? Just come out early. You know, we can sleep over on Saturday night, praise the Lord. No, but just come as early as possible, and then, you know, we're going to try to accommodate everybody. There's going to be a lot of people coming. Don't stay, because some people say, well, I'm going to stay home and give it to somebody else. That's why we spread it out. We want people, because you people love worshiping God. We want to make sure that you people are here to worship God and work together and meet someone, amen? So we're excited today. We're going to finish our series on Uninhibited. And so today we're going to wrap this up. So let's open up in prayer. Lord God, I just thank you for your faithfulness. I thank you for the great work you're doing in this house. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We don't uplift up a name of a church, a name of a pastor. We lift up the name of Jesus. It's all about you, Lord God. I'm so grateful for the people who are here, and especially those who are here for the first time. I pray that already you've touched them, that they sense the love of God, the peace of God, the joy of God. They sense that they belong. And if they're looking for a church, I pray that you would put it in their heart, their home, they're here. And I pray, Lord God, in Jesus' name, that we will all continue to grow and to give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. So like I said before, we've been in this series, Uninhibited, and we've been talking about the contrast between what is an uninhibited life and an inhibited life. And I put this thing up, and we can look at it. What's the difference between an uninhibited life and an inhibited life? So first of all, an uninhibited life is a life with no hesitation. You're a risk taker and no fear. And this is, as a Christian, this is the kind of life God wants each and every one of us to live. Then there's the inhibited life. Boo, we don't want that, right? That's when you're being held back, when you constrain and have no risk. Willing to take no risk. And so we've been talking about this whole month about a couple of things. The one thing is that as Christians, God has given us the ability to live an uninhibited life. Why? Because we are free from sin. We're no longer slaves to sin. How many of us are free in Christ? Amen? And it said, the Bible says, whom the Son sets free is what? Free indeed. And then the next week we talked about uninhibited obedience. God commands us to obey him even when it hurts. And that was one of our ouch messages. And last week, I don't know about you, but I loved the tremendous sermon by Pastor Carlos on uninhibited generosity. I know some of you were like, well, I don't know. I gave away all my money, now I'm broke. But I'm waiting for that check to come in the mail tomorrow. Praise the Lord. And today I want to talk about something else that sometimes we as Christians, I'm talking about myself as well, sometimes we feel inhibited. But God wants us to be uninhibited in this area, and this is the area what I'm talking about specifically is when it comes to evangelism. Evangelism. Evangelism, what does it mean? Proclaiming the good news with others. Now, how many know being a Christian is more than just God getting your life together and answering your prayers. That's nice. Isn't that nice? But how many of you know that's more than just being a Christian for that? How many know it's more than just going to heaven? I'm glad I'm going to heaven when I die. How many of you glad? How many of you know that you're going? Now, don't sound so. I know that I'm going. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. I know where I'm going. And so what happens is, and so we know where we're going, but the reason why the church exists is because God has created us to go out and to proclaim the message, the good news of the gospel, the good news of salvation to each and every person. He tells us, he commands us, he says, I want you to go out and to the world and spread the good news. Now, I think a lot of us know that. How many of you know that already? Even online, those who watch it, but I know, put your emoji hand up, all right? Praise the Lord. And so you know it, but it's one of those things that we know in Christian, but we don't always practice. Because how many know we talk a good game? Talking about myself. Revealing God, reaching people, restoring lives. That's what I'm all about. Yes. I'm the three R's. And then to me, I don't know about you, but sometimes I feel guilty when I hear a message on evangelism. Why? Because I can't remember the last time I spoke to someone one-on-one about the gospel. That's the truth. I've done it in public. But when was the last time perhaps you? Don't want you to put your hand up. I don't want to give you a guilt trip. But that's something that we need to consider because we know we have to do this. But why aren't we doing it? So let's look at several reasons why we have an issue with evangelizing. For reasons for uninhibited evangelism. Looks foolish. What I mean by that is sometimes it's all about us and all about me. How do I look? I want to make sure that I present myself well. And so it's like, it's not about you. It's all about Jesus. Amen? And sometimes we simply have to get ourselves out. Sometimes we think too highly of ourselves. And we are servants of the Most High, and it's about delivering the message. Sometimes we fear rejection. Fear rejection from our family members. Don't bring that up. I'm Catholic. Soy católico. No, no me hable de esto. Don't talk to me about that. And how many of us know of people, perhaps we work with, people in our family, people in our community, people we live with. Every time you mention the gospel, they say, yo, I don't want to hear it. And so part of this is like, what if this person, sometimes the Lord tells you, speak to this person about Jesus or share the good news. You're like, well, I don't know. They don't look like they want to receive it, right? Or even fear persecution, because some areas, in some places, you fear persecution. You can lose your job. You know, people just treat you different. Around the world, we see tremendous persecution just for lifting up the name of Jesus. So people fear they don't know enough. They simply don't know enough about the gospel. You know, they think that evangelism is for the experts. That's why we pay you, Pastor. I gave you my offering this week, so you need to go out there and tell some people about souls. But how many know it's not just for pastors, not just for evangelists, not just for apostles, not just for prophets. Oh, people love titles, teachers. They love titles. In the church. But out there, that title don't mean anything if you're not sharing the good news. Procrastination. I'll do it next week. What's the rush? That's the biggest weapon the enemy has over us. Tell him, do it later. I'll talk to my family member later. Not right now. We get so caught up. How many of us, and I'm guilty of it, I get so caught up on things just to get a breath of fresh air or just to take 5 minutes. Because I'm doing so many things. How many of you live that kind of life? Most of us. I think most of the people live that kind of life. You're always busy, so you're procrastinating. I don't have time to share. Assuming they're not interested. Sometimes you look at people around us and they're not interested. Or some people, we may even think that they're unsavable. You look at some people and from different maybe ethnic groups or different lifestyles, and you look at them and you say, they don't want Jesus. I hear in the news that all they do is hate Jesus. So I'm not even going to mention Jesus to them. I guess God will take care of it. but God is sending you. And we have to understand that God, and people sometimes we make excuses. It says, well, God has not given me the gift of evangelism. Because we see in Ephesians 4:11 that it's a gift, the gift of evangelism. But how many know that God has called each? There's some people who do it very well with excellence. I mean, I think of my sister Jackie and the team, the gold team, praise the Lord. She bold. You don't know Jackie. She'll tell you about Jesus in a second. You know what I'm saying? But me, I take the more quiet route. You know what I'm saying? I got to play in the sandbox a little bit before I tell you about Jesus. Jackie be like, you need Jesus? I got to tell you about Jesus right now. And some of y'all are like that, and I praise God for that. But how many say I'm not at that level? But that doesn't mean that God has not called us to evangelize. We can't just leave it to Jackie. God has called each and every one of us to evangelize. And that's what I want to encourage you today. This message is not going to bash you, all right? Because sometimes, oh my God, evangelism, all right, I got to do it. I'll do it. No, I want to encourage you by looking at the life of Jesus, the example that Jesus set for us today. And we're going to see three ways where we can be encouraged to live the uninhibited life when it comes to evangelism. And we're going to look at Jesus' example that Jesus set in Matthew 9, verses 35 to 39. And here it says, Jesus went throughout. You got it? Open your apps. I know, go fast. I got it here. So, Mitchell, you have it. I mean, give me a second. All right. Matthew 9, 35 to 39. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. Amen. Put yourself in there. Those of you who are a couple of minutes, you write down the scripture. It says every, not some, not the ones the doctor says is curable, but every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowd, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, I love this part. Wonder why? The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into what? His harvest fields. That's the origin of our church, all right? That's how we got the name, this verse right here. So we see three things that we have to understand if we want to live that uninhibited evangelistic life. He says, Lord God, that's what I want. The first thing you see from an example that Jesus said is that he connected with people. Connected with people. Let's look at verse 35 again. Jesus went throughout all the towns and villages, teaching in the synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom. So you notice right here that Jesus was going out and he was non-discriminatory. He was just went out and he began to, the minute the ministry started, he was going and sharing the word. At first, he would go to the synagogue. Why? Because he was Jewish. How many know Jesus was Jewish, all right? So Jesus was Jewish. He would first go into the synagogues to just preach the good news. But they weren't interested. Why weren't they interested? Because they were self-righteous. They were just thinking they were holier than thou. They said, who are you? You ain't nobody. So Jesus didn't just preach in the synagogue. How many know sometimes we preach it to one another, but God is saying, I need you to go out and follow the example of Jesus, because Jesus went out there. He went, it says, throughout the towns. Why? Because he cared about people. He cared for the Jews. He cared for the Gentiles. He cared for the people who were marginalized. He cared for the people that were outcast. He cared about all these things. He would go once they reject him in the synagogue, but he went out there. And it tells us the kind of people that Jesus hung out with. That's very, very important. It says tax collectors and sinners. Because we know what sinners, tax collectors, I don't know. Well, maybe the people that collect our taxes are bad people. But that's not what he's talking about, right? These were people that are taking advantage of their own people. And so, but he was hanging out. So why did Jesus gravitate to these people? Because he saw the need. He went out of it. He was intentional about connecting with them. And throughout scripture, we see that he connected with different people. He connected with the leper. These people were diseased. And you got to understand, at that time, if you had disease or you were crippled, you were not allowed to go into the synagogue. And so, in other words, so they wouldn't be in a synagogue, but Jesus knew that, so he went out. So he went to the pool of Bethesda. He went out and he found, and so even those people that weren't Jews, because Gentiles could not go into the synagogue. In fact, in the temple, they had a section their own section where it's own Gentiles only. And that was, remember when Jesus turned over the table, when he turned over the tables? And remember, people said, well, Jesus don't want you to sell nothing in the church. That, no, the reason why is because they set up in the place of the Gentiles. Where they were supposed to worship, they couldn't worship because they were giving out, you know, temple coins, selling it. And they were trading all this stuff. So he was here, but Jesus knew that. And so Jesus went out to the Gentiles. You got to understand, Jews and Gentiles did not associate. In fact, the Gentiles were sort of like being dismissed. In fact, Jesus even called them one time the dogs, right? So we understand that. But Jesus had a heart. He connected with those who were outsiders. The centurion, the woman at the well. All these, we know, many of you know about the woman at the well. That woman was a Samaritan. Jewish people and Samaritans did not get along. Could not even be in the same room. But Jesus connected with these people. He gravitated to the outcast, to the prostitute, to those who are outcast. And so we have to look at this and say the pattern is that Jesus intentionally connected with the lost. And so the question we need to ask ourselves, and I ask myself, how connected am I to the lost? Because I have found, now I've been in the church 40 years plus. Since I backslid, I gave my life to the Lord. 40 years, some of you not even 40. All right, I'm old. All right, I get it. But 40 years plus, and I don't know about you, but what has happened over the 40 years, I sort of like disengaged myself with those who are out there in the world. The church culture became my culture, and it became everything to me, and I wasn't intentional. Oops,
good Lord.
Anyway, oops. All right. It wasn't intentional, but it just happened that way. And so eventually, I got so involved in the things of church, I couldn't go to my family thing. I couldn't do this. I couldn't do that. And then eventually, we didn't have common interests anymore. How many say, the reason I don't hang out with my friends, what you did this weekend? Oh, we praised the Lord. Oh, you know what I'm saying? God was in the house and everything. And what did you do?
Smoked up.
And sometimes we feel funny because you know what? We hang out with people who are not Christian and they're telling us a story. And I don't know about you, but when I used to tell stories, I curse. Every sentence had a flavor curse. I was the kind of person I could not tell a story without a curse.
Don't be lying. Some of you used to be that way, man.
Some of you still that way, but we're praying for you. We're praying for you. Keep coming to church. Don't give up.
I'm serious.
And so after a while, I became so this. So all my friends are Christian. Everyone that I hang out is Christian. I go to Christian concerts. Everything Christian, 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 Christian. And so when it says reach the lost, well, I don't know anyone. That was my excuse. Oh, my friends, I pray for them at the altar. That's what I do. But how many know that was something that God is continually working on me, that I have to be intentional about making those connections, making those connections, especially people who are different than us. And we look in our communities, and our communities are changing. Those of us who've been in the Bronx, especially in this area for maybe like the last couple of years, maybe the last 10, 20 years, we see the dynamic, the change and the ethnic groups that are coming in. And sometimes we believe because if they're the other group, we have nothing to do with them. I spoke to a pastor and I was saying, you know what, there's a lot of Muslims coming now. How are we going to reach them? And I was sort of excited. You know, God give us the strategy to reach them. And he said, I'm not interested in reaching those people.
Really? You a pastor?
He just closed his church. Just closed it. This year. Not me. I see it as a challenge. I see it as a challenge to reach the other. Reach the other. What I mean by other is those who are not like us. You know, sometimes we see someone from the LGBTQ community, and the first thing we want to do is, come on, demon, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. What? Chill. You don't even know their name. You don't even know their story. And that's why it's so, so important. I'm not, oh, but I'm a Christian, and we got to separate ourselves. Yes, we're insulated with Christ, but not isolated. We're insulated, but not isolated. And so what does that mean? I had to intentionally begin to build relationships with people who are not Christian. My wife and I, we started taking since last year's salsa class every Friday. Cachet down the block, plug. Give me that and Saturday. Give me a plug. Give me a discount. Praise the Lord, Jose. Jose, Leah's here. Her sister Leah. She's there, and she's there, and we're there. And you know what? And I'm connecting with people who are not Christian. Okay, sometimes they curse. Oh, I'm offended. Man, I used to curse all the time. That was my normal language, right? My brother knows, right? he knows. He's going to write the book. and so what I'm saying is I'm connecting with these people. How do we connect with people? Let's look at this list. How do we connect? Find out who they are. It's relational. You got to build relationships with people. Do you know the name of the people in the bodega? Do you know the names of the people in the Dunkin' Donuts? Because I know some of you support that ministry more than Harvest. Praise the Lord. You're giving your 10% to Dunkin', and the church ain't getting nothing. No, well, like Pastor Evelyn says, I don't have nothing, but you got a donut in your hand, you had something. I got nothing for you, Lord. Find out who they are. Pastor Joseph, Deacon, he's going to be a pastor. That's why I keep on. But he's going to be, he's got the calling. He's got that connection. I mean, people come here all the time. They're looking for Deacon Joseph. Where's Joseph? He knows the people in Dunkin'. In fact, when I go to Dunkin' and I order my matcha, you know what I say? Make it the way Joseph likes it. And they all know what I'm talking about. I'm telling you, next time you go, if you get a matcha, go there. I'm not lying. Make it like Joe. But how he's building the relationship. Oh, but they're Muslim. Oh. No. But first of all, we got to build a relationship with them. How many of you, I'm sure we work with people in the LGBTQ community. I'm sure they're all around us, but we don't talk about it in church, right? That's the elephant in the room. What about them? Oh, no, I guess they're not going to heaven. No, but just begin. They may reject God. They may reject, but that doesn't give an excuse to say that these people are unreachable. Amen? Real quick, what are their deepest concerns? Know their cultures and believe. Know what they believe. What do they believe? If we know there's a lot of Muslims here, I'm reading a book now. What do they believe? I don't know. They believe in a God. They believe in one God, but it's not the God, our God. And they don't believe. And the big thing is they believe Jesus is only a prophet, and we believe that he's the Messiah. He's the Son of God, and that's the big difference. Show them your heart. Show them that you care. How many people would listen to you if you show them you care? Because some of us, you know, we get this, you know, I'm going to tell you about Jesus because I want to win one for the church and I want to beat the devil up and I want to argue with you. That's not the way to do it. Show them you care. You care about their soul. You care the way they live. Pray for opportunities to share. An opportunity, there's an opportunity. How many on the bus is an opportunity? I'm looking at time. All right, so real quick, I went to a conference it was in New Orleans, right? New Orleans, I went to a conference, and we said, let's take the bus like a locals, me and a couple pastors. And so we took the local, and of course I got on the bus, and I did my Bronx thing, right? Because we know, we get on the bus, we don't know, people be like... And what? Nobody better mess with me. Don't talk to me. Don't look at me. Gonna be in trouble. You don't know me. I am crazy. I'm really crazy. And I was like with my heart look. And I was just daydreaming. And 5 minutes later, I saw my friend talking to these young kids about Jesus. He said, oh, I love music. I said, oh, you love music? And I said, he took back then in the day, he took out a CD and says, yo, this is a gospel artist I want you to listen to. Do you know about Jesus? And I was amazed. I was amazed on the bus. That was a 10-minute ride. And sometimes the Lord will lead us. And that's not the way I am. But see, if I was so, once again, I was so into myself. Into me, you know, when I say, nah, nobody's going to mess with me. that I missed an opportunity. And many of us miss opportunities that are all around us. God will prompt you. He will tell you, tell that person, I'm praying. Just find out, even the simplest thing is, can I pray for you? What can I pray for you? And everybody, I don't care who you are, where you are, everybody needs prayer, wants prayer. And take the initiative to share. And then, so we're going on the second thing. Let's go on real quick. The second thing is, in order for us to be evangelized uninhibitedly, we have to have compassion. He said, when we saw the crowd, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd, verse 36. What does compassion mean? Compassion is to have mercy, to feel sympathy, and to have pity. In this verse, we see the heart of Jesus. It says he looked in the crowd. What did he see? Everybody that he was about to condemn? No, he saw that they were broken, that they were harassed. He saw their future state. He saw how sin had binded them. He saw how they were religious, or they were trying to find him. But the religious people at that time were getting in the way of them truly serving God. They had too many laws, too many restrictions that they weren't able to find Jesus. So the people who were leading were blind, and they were leading the blind, and they were going nowhere. So Jesus saw all these things. He had compassion on them. And so the question is asked, what do we see when we look into a crowd? Sometimes I look at people and I'm like, man, on social media, and I see people all around parades and or just doing stuff. And what do you see? What do you feel? Do you feel what Jesus felt? These people don't know Jesus. And people that don't know Jesus, I don't know about you, when I don't know Jesus, I did some crazy stuff. And they're doing some crazy stuff. And we look at them and says, oh, have, you know, strike them down, Jesus, strike them down. But pray for compassion. Pray through, look at them, begin to look at them through the eyes of compassion. Compassion is like, I want to do something. I want to do something. I feel I can do something. And each and every one of us have a group of people. Some of you feel that you're compassionate for children. And the RFK program we have here, they're for foster kids. Why? Because someone had that compassion and love, and now we're reaching 40 kids every summer. We're taking them to camp. We're doing all this stuff. But what's your people group? Mine is you. To me, that when I look at the people who've been marginalized, the people who's always dismissed, because all my life I always felt dismissed. But when I look at people, when I feel dismissed, I feel that I need to do something. I need to stand up for them. I call it the holy discontent. That Bill Hybels, he said, this holy discontent, when you experience an uneasy spirit about the brokenness of this world, which aligns with the heart of God and spurs up to take positive action and to make positive change. It's one thing to look at it. It's another thing to do something about it. That's faith in action, because a lot of us have faith, but what James says, faith without works is what dead. And so we have to take the action and then go on your compassion. Do you care about the people out there? Do you care? And to me, like if you're here on Wednesday morning or on Friday, you see that people lining up all over to get to being fed. I mean, I'm talking about around the block. And then I look at these people and I say, Lord God, these people, most of them perhaps don't know you. They're from other cultures, and I said, God, my heart goes out. So when I'm going down the line, I'm praying, Lord God, release your spirit in it. As I'm going to my, release your spirit, break the chains right now in the name of Jesus. You know each and every one of them. I don't know who's trying to commit suicide, but I come against that. I come against generational curses. God bless you. How you doing? Amen. Praise the Lord. How you doing? Yes. And then I start all the way to the door, and I see them with the eyes of compassion. And as my wife said, Charlotte, it's that we believe that God is going to make somehow use, and I don't know how he's going to do it, but somehow he's going to use us to reach the Muslim people, and it's going to be a big, big revival. We're believing for revival. Listen to the vision statement we said in the first, if you don't know what I'm talking about. But we see it, compassion. Connections lead to compassion. People will hear us once they know we care. And through compassion, we can change the lives of someone else. You can make a difference in people. Do you have compassion for the people in your office? Even that that coworker that everybody's talking about. Because it's easy for you to go co-sign. Oh, yeah, we hate her too. Or we hate him too. But do you have compassion? Why are they that way? Because they're bound in sin. The angry supervisor, you can go down the list of the people. There's something in your heart that when you pass it, you say to yourself, man, what can I do? And God said, you can do a lot by sharing the good news with them. The last thing is that in order for us to live an uninhibited, the first thing, well, what was it? We need to connect, right? Then we need to have compassion. The third thing is we need to call on God. Look, verse 37 and 38. Then he said to the disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. So Jesus right here, he was telling us that first of all, we have to understand there's no shortage of people who are not Christian. I'm glad this church is full. And second service, balcony, basement. But how many know there's so many more people out there that need to know about Jesus? In the Bronx, it's estimated that 472 million people in the Bronx alone. In the Bronx alone. That's why your apartment complex is so crowded, right? In the Bronx alone, and there's so many people. And to me, I said, Lord God, we have to go to three services. We got to do what we got to do. That's why it's not just about Harvest Fields. I don't promote Harvest Fields. I promote the kingdom of God. And I know there's great churches out there, Life Together, Fellowship, Promised Land, Sanctuary Fellowship, all these churches that I know, the brotherhood and of people that we come together and pray because we know we cannot win the Bronx by ourselves, but we need to connect. And so here, Jesus, because sometimes Jesus saw something, because see, Jesus, because he was in his humanity, he chose to limit his ministry. He could only be one place at a time. He was human. He was tired. It says he thirsted. He was tired. He was hungry. So we see all these things. But we need to pray. So what he says, he tells us to pray to who? God the Father. Pray to the Lord of the harvest. He is the Lord of the harvest. What? To send laborers into the harvest fields. So each and every one of us has a responsibility. If we see the need and we know that it's a lot, but I don't get overwhelmed. Sometimes it's easy to get overwhelmed and say, God, I could reach the person one person at a time. What are you calling me to go out? Because prayer and evangelism go hand in hand. Prayer and evangelism go hand in hand. So what we begin to pray for? Pray that God will stir the hearts of the people of the church. Stir your heart. When was the last time your heart cried for those who were lost? When was the last, like I said before, for me, I'm guilty of, when was the last time I shared the word, the good news with one person? If I don't remember, then God wants me to do that. That our actions speak louder than words. That every Christian needs to do their part. We need to pray for the lost and pray that God will send workers out. Not more work. We use that, oh, God, we need more ushers. How many know what Jesus said? You know, pray for the Lord of the harvest to send more laborers into the harvest fields. He wasn't talking about the church. He wasn't talking about getting us more ushers. We need more ushers, but he wasn't talking about that. He was talking about going out in the street and reaching people. And that's what we need to do. We need to pray and reach the people in your building. Don't wait for the past day. This is the thing I say. You're the only Jesus most people will ever see. You're waiting for people to come into church. They're not going to come to the church. You're waiting for them to read the Bible. Most people don't even know how to read, let alone look at the Bible. And so we have to understand that you are the Jesus representative. You are the ambassador of Christ. You are the one that needs to go out there and begin to share the good news with each and every person. You don't have to have a pulpit. You don't have to have the microphone. You just go one-on-one in the laundromat. When you're washing your clothes, you tell somebody about Jesus. In the supermarket, at Key Food, when you're on the line, you do it. Everywhere you go, you mention when back again in Dunkin' Donuts. Well, most of you will go after the service in the name of Jesus. Right? We pray that God will stir up our hearts and make this connection. And this is the thing. You're not going to, sometimes my fire has died for the Lord. And what does that mean? Because I have to reconnect. Years ago, I got a call that says, hey, we need some pastors to go to Rikers and to minister to some of the young youth there. It was every Tuesday, 1 o'clock to like 4 o'clock. And, you know, if you've been in Rikers, well, don't answer that. All right, so to visit someone in Rikers, let me redirect this. All right, to visit someone in Rikers, it's a long process. I mean, you got to show. I mean, just a long, tedious process, but we did it, and we connected, and God put that heart, man. I used to get back in my car, tears. Got to reconnect. You got to reconnect with the lost. It's one thing to do it in church and be the most best person in the church, but we have to reconnect and ask the Lord that he would stir up your hearts once again to expose you. You need exposure, The problem is not that we're not getting enough. The problem is not that there's not enough souls that need Jesus. There's not enough laborers to get them. And the best thing about it, I'm going to finish real quick, is the best thing is that the God gives us the Holy Spirit power. We don't do it on our own. Let's look at Acts 1a. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes to you, and you will be my witness in the Jerusalem and all Judah, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. We have a Holy Spirit advantage. We have the Holy Spirit power to give you the boldness. He will give you the boldness. He will give you the discernment. He will give you, because how many of you know when you begin to pray for people, God answers that prayer through the name of Jesus. When someone, and that's what I'm praying right now, every time I see someone, Lord God, they can say that you are Jesus, that you are not God. But once in the name of Jesus, you heal their daughter, you deliver them from that addiction, you deliver them, they're going to call on Jesus. I know they're serving another God right now, but once the miracle working power begins to move, that's why I pray that anybody who passes in front of the church in the name of Jesus, that they will feel the Holy Spirit power, that they will be entrapped by the Holy Spirit power, that they will be delivered in the name of Jesus. That's only by the power of God. And everywhere you go, where you walk is holy ground. In your office, you declare that for Jesus Christ. In your school, you declare it for Jesus Christ. In your home, you declare it for Jesus Christ. Everywhere you go in the name of Jesus, you declare it for Jesus Christ. Pray that God get rid of the fear, the fear, the fear, the fear, the fear. Fear. The harvest is ripe. That's the message that the Lord told me last year in January. The harvest is ripe. In other words, there's a lot of people out there. We need to do our work. I'm going to give you some homework, some practical stuff. Put up that the gold thing if you have it. This, put your money where your mouth is. Faith is what works. And I know some of us, it's a scary thing. They're going to Bruckner. You know what I'm saying? Bruckner, where am I going to Bruckner? One thing I know there is Kentucky Fried Chicken, praise the Lord, and the White Castle later on. but going out, that this is the thing where you need to go out. And you may be intimidated. Believe me, I haven't done this in a long time. And it builds, and that's one way to do it. That's one. There are different ways to evangelize. That's one way to evangelize. The next thing is invite people to church. Pay that $10 for their concert. I said, I want to give you a free concert. Come to this concert. Pay enough for yourself. If you have it, do it. Or bring them Sunday. Bring them Sunday. Come early. Bring them in. Bring them in. Bring them in. I said, oh, church is too crowded. They're not gonna get in. Just get here on time. Get here a little early. But that's how we do it. That all of us got to do it. We're praying. But see, because I believe the Lord is stirring the hearts of our people. We've been praying. We are believing. And we're going to call on God. Go ministry this Saturday. See, Jackie. Jackie, stand up for a second. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. There's our wonderful sister, Jackie. And the team, they're ready to go. I said, well, I'm on Saturday. You should have told me last week because I got to go to a bar mitzvah. All right, fine. How many know that throughout the year, commit yourself to at least one? Commit yourself to one. See, that's being caught up. I said, oh, I got all my Saturdays for the rest of the year. I'm sorry. But some people are going on a missions trip. They're doing all these different things. So I'm going to close right now. I believe the Lord has spoken. I believe he said it, so I don't need to say anything anymore. So let's bow our heads right now at this moment. Lord God, when you saw the crowd, you had compassion. When you see the Bronx, Lord God, you have compassion. I know people often rag on the Bronx, talk about the Bronx, put down the Bronx, but you love the people of the Bronx. You die for the people of the Bronx. It's a privilege to serve in the Bronx. It's a privilege, those who live here, Lord God, it's a privilege to live here. We are the light, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, that you would help us to connect. Help us to connect, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Some of us need to call our friends again and hang out with our family members or just connect. Find a way to connect at the gym or the laundry. Begin to connect. Some of you need to pray and say, Lord God, give me more compassion. Give me my compassion, Lord God. My heart needs to break, Lord God. For the lost. That's only from God. That's only from Jesus. The third thing we need to pray, call on God and say, Lord God, pray that you will stir up the hearts. That Harvest Field won't be the happening church because we got nice music, just because we got nice music, or because we got good, you know, have fun time in services and we're very busy. But no, we're reaching souls. We're revealing God, reaching people and restoring lives. So Lord God, I pray for each and every person here. Let us remember, when we go to the doctor's office, God says, can I use you? When you're on the train, can I use you? When you're in the store, can I use you? Can I just prompt it in your heart, share this word, tell them about Jesus, do whatever. This week, Lord God, as the Go Ministry, we're praying and believing, Lord God, as they go out in the Bruckner, we pray, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, that you would touch their hearts and touch, stir up the hearts of people here to do something about it. And Lord God, we're going to ask the prayer team to come up at this moment. If you are a person who is hearing this and you're in church because, you know, it's the right thing to do. It's Easter week. This is the week I get my life right with Jesus. You're in the right place because Jesus is not here to condemn you. He's here to love you. You may be far away from him or feel that you're far away, but he's not far away from you. He's as close as the mention of his name. Call on the name of the Lord and you shall be saved. So right now, if you desire to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, because the Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, there's a gap. We cannot get to God the Father ourselves. We need Jesus who died on the cross, who rose again and in power. And through Jesus Christ, when you invite him into your life as Lord and Savior and ask him to forgive you of your sins, you become saved. You become born again. You become a new creation in Christ. The chains of sin are broken. You are transferred out of the world of darkness into his marvelous light. Into his kingdom. So right now, if there's anybody who desires to know Jesus Christ, I want you to come up right now. We're not going to postpone it because of the time, but if you want Jesus, I want you to come up right now in the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Those who are backslidden, those who are addicted, and I praise for the Lord, and I pray for those of you who have been dealing with addiction. You've been dealing with addiction right now in the name of Jesus. And you're saying, God, I'm going to try harder. I'm going to try harder. But God is saying right now in the name of Jesus, I can help you. I can help you. I can help you. I can help you. God is able. You don't have to do this on your own. Don't let fear, don't let pride keep you in your seat in the name of Jesus. We've all been there. Many of us could testify. Many of these people here could testify that God delivered them from drugs. God delivered them from anger. God delivered them from lust. God delivered them from brokenness. God delivered them from shame in the name of Jesus. Now, how many of us are saying, God, I want uninhibited. I want to be live an uninhibited life when it comes to evangelism. How many of you, that's you, I want you to stand up. Praise the Lord. Stand up right now if you says, I want to live an uninhibited life of evangelism. I know you're touching me, Lord God. I know that you're touching me. So right now, as the worship team, they're going to worship God. We're going to worship God together. I want you to lift your hand. I want you to dedicate your situation, whatever you're going through. Let's lift up the name of Jesus. Everybody, let's get up now and at this moment. Let's worship God together. We're going to worship God. Let's lift up our hands. If you need prayer for sickness or whatever, there are people here that want to pray with you. We believe in the power of God. And in Jesus' name, we want to pray. If you're sick or whatever, we want to pray with you. God bless you. Let's worship God together. Amen.
give ourselves to you. We give ourselves to you as a living sacrifice so that we can be used for your glory. We want to be used for your glory, God, in this earth. We want to be used, Lord, as your hands and as your feet in the earth, Lord, so that you get the glory, so that you get the honor. Lord, we lay ourselves down at your feet. And Lord, we just ask, God, that you would just continue to use us. We surrender our lives to you again. Lord, we thank you for what you have done in this place. And God, that you are continuing to use us, that you are continuing even outside of this room. Lord, that you are going to send us out to be your mouthpiece in the earth, Lord. We surrender again. Lord, we thank you, we love you, we honor you, and we bless your name. In Jesus' name, amen. Harvest, have a great day, have a great week.